Hey there, it's Alina, your friendly nuclear physicist, and today we are reacting to yet another Kurzgesagt video. They recently made a video about shooting nuclear waste into space, and you guys did not miss any time and wrote in the comment section that you would like me to check it out and react to it. I'm gonna leave the link to the original video down below so you can check it out, and without further ado, let's get into it.
Here in the Kurzgesagt labs, we test very important ideas to see what happens when you blow things up or play with black holes.
That's important.
Many of you suggested that we look into an idea that sounds reasonable, shooting nuclear waste into space.
Not sure if it sounds reasonable, but definitely sounds tempting.
It's one of those concepts that seems like an easy fix for one of the main problems with nuclear energy. But it turns out this idea is not just bad, but horribly bad, and it gets worse the longer you think about it.
I'm not sure who thinks that it is an easy fix to shoot nuclear waste into space, and one could just give the very simple and quick example of what would happen if, for example, the rocket malfunctioned halfway going out of the atmosphere and just dropped down, and then you have an atmosphere that is full of radioactive waste particles, pieces of uranium flying around and contaminating pretty much the whole Earth. So that scenario alone, besides pretty much anything else that can go wrong, is not making the nuclear waste into space case look very appealing.
What is nuclear waste? Nuclear waste is a fuzzy term and comes in categories which vary from country to country. But in general, there are three broad levels. 90% is low-level nuclear waste, tools, gloves, or trash used at a nuclear facility that could be weakly contaminated with some short-lived radioactivity. This stuff is generally safe for normal disposal. 7% is intermediate level nuclear waste, mostly materials that have been in close proximity to a reactor core long enough to become dangerously radioactive. With proper handling, it's either safely buried or melted down and mixed into glass or concrete and stored deep underground. So 97% of nuclear waste.
So of course the green goo representing the nuclear waste would be here as well. Even though I was expecting a different, let's say, representation of waste from Kurzgesagt, I'll give it that it looks cartoony. Doesn't really look realistic though. So we have explained it in the past that, of course, this is a misconception. Nothing green or gooey gets out of any part of the fuel or the reactor itself. So I'm not sure where it came from, but it's definitely sci-fi. As it comes for the waste, yes, as we discussed also in one of my previous videos, there is three categories of waste, and the low waste is pretty much, as he said, that gloves or some kind of equipment like that can either be stored or even decontaminated if necessary, if it's an equipment that is multi-use. And intermediate waste is either put into concrete or stored underground. And I'm assuming he's going to discuss about the high-level waste, which is the one that makes sense to send into space, because the cost sending something into space would be so high that it wouldn't make any sense to send something that is not so highly radioactive or, let's say, dangerous for our planet. Let's see.
Is similar to toxic byproducts from other industries. Not great, not terrible. We can handle it. The remaining 3% is where our problems begin. High-level nuclear waste is very concentrated spent fuel taken out of a reactor core. Formerly uranium, it's now made of various...
If we would like to, let's say, fact-check this part of the infographics, you don't remove the radioactive spent fuel, the uranium rods, from the reactor and lifting them up in the air and then in a, like, let's say, transferring either container or a vehicle, like in this case, because the moment you remove it out, you have no shielding that the water provides inside the reactor. So radiation is basically coming out of the fuel and into the atmosphere and passing through the air, and it would pretty much radiate through the people, the workers, all of the environment around the nuclear reactor building. So it's not really how it works. What would be more accurate if there would be a pool path, so like a path which was still submerged into water, through which the fuel was basically dragged along until it reaches its container or some sort of specific room that is shielded in which it can be, let's say, handled in a dry form.
Dangerous and often highly radioactive elements. As a bonus, it's also incredibly hot and not easy to handle at all. This is what we want to shoot into space. All in all, around 440 active nuclear reactors create about 11,000 tons of high-level nuclear waste each year. Since 1954, we've accumulated 400,000 tons of dangerous radioactive waste. Most countries are dealing with it by not dealing with it and kicking the can towards the future.
Again, here we come with a funny way of representing it, more of a cartoony approach. We have already discussed in videos in the past that most of the countries have ideas and have approaches to storing nuclear waste. And even though the permanent repositories might not be built yet in most of the countries, the waste is still maintained and properly contained in the spent nuclear fuel pools where it's cooling down and its radioactivity is dropping. So again, if I was to make the infographics here, I would be placing the roads inside the pool while saying that yes, most of the countries as of now don't really have a permanent solution in place, even though they already have, let's say, in paper solutions for that.
Great, so let's launch it into space. According to scientists, space is big and nobody lives there, so it seems perfect for yeeting away this mess. There are a few tiny problems though.
Tiny.
Problem one, stuff ain't cheap.
Yes.
Even though spaceflight is getting more affordable, it's still extremely expensive. Just to get something into low Earth orbit costs on average about $4,000 per kilogram. Putting that into perspective, it costs about $1,600 to mine, separate and fabricate 1 kilogram of nuclear fuel, so launching waste into space has suddenly made nuclear fuel for reactors way more expensive and greatly increased the cost of the electricity they produce. To launch one reactor's worth of nuclear waste would cost at least $100 million per year. To deal with all the 440 operational nuclear power plants' high-level nuclear waste would cost some $44 billion per year for space launch before packaging, transport and security costs are added. Okay, let's...
And this is not adding into cost, of course, some sort of malfunction that will happen or any kind of extra cost that usually is added once you start, let's say, the process of launching them into space. Generally, as you can tell, the economics, even though it's not the main reason why we are not shooting nuclear waste into space, it's definitely one of the reasons that is not attractive to companies or even governments and countries. Is because it would increase the nuclear price of nuclear energy even higher than it already is by building reactors one of a kind, like we already explained, instead of using SMRs, like I said in my previous video. Definitely the economics is not in our favor in this one.
And we don't care. Currently, we couldn't shoot all the nuclear waste into space even if we wanted to. There just aren't enough rockets. In 2021, we saw a record 135 launches into space. If we repurposed each of those rockets and filled them all with nuclear waste, the total amount that could be lifted into a low Earth orbit, which is the closest orbit above the atmosphere, is nearly 800 tons. We'd need at least 14 times more rockets to handle just today's nuclear waste, let alone get rid of the hundreds of thousands of tons in temporary storage.
So this has some accuracy to it, and of course if you would want to launch all of this waste, it would be a very big amount that you would have to handle and probably would not be able to handle based on these numbers. That's why there is all sorts of research and let's say work into trying and finding ways to somehow separate the even the high level waste into the fuel itself and the cladding around the fuel and other components that might not necessarily need to be, let's say, launched into space. So only the necessary fuel and cladding, for example, is the one that will go into outer space. But even in this case scenario, the fuel itself would be very heavy, would require a lot of propulsion power, energy would be required for that. Financially, it is not favorable. So far, case not looking good.
We would need to create entire new space industries to keep up with the demand for giant, toxic space trash trucks. And it gets worse. Problem two, space is hard. We only made the calculation for low Earth orbit, where we send most of our rockets and satellites. Littering the space around Earth with thousands of casks of spent nuclear fuel would be a nightmare for space junk management and satellite collision avoidance. Worse still, at this altitude, there's still a little bit of atmosphere causing a tiny bit of drag, so we might have nuclear waste raining down from space within just a few years.
And that's definitely a very appealing case to make for it. In case you shoot some container into outer space and it crashes with one of the satellites or something, and then it starts falling down like a nice green glowy rain, apparently.
Experts would call this a huge problem. Clearly, we have...
I'm sure non-experts would call it a very big problem as well.
...to launch our waste further. If we wanted to send it to, perhaps, the moon, we either need way more rockets or we need to build much bigger ones.
There is actually research that has been done in the world from NASA, from Stanford University, from MIT, that I can put up here so you can check it out if you need more details or if you're more interested in it, that actually examines the possibility to shooting nuclear waste into outer space. And they do examine two most, let's say, favored scenarios. The one that would be launching it to the moon because it's nearby, and the other one would be launching it straight to the sun. I'm not sure which one of them sounds weirder than the other, but definitely launching it to the moon, which is the closest satellite, natural satellite that we have near Earth, doesn't look like the best case scenario, especially if we are planning to do some more exploration or some more activities in the moon. Imagine then there would be some possibilities that we could do as humankind something on the moon, but then we cannot go there because we dumped all kinds of nuclear waste there, and now how can we even handle that when we are in the outer space? So it creates all of this confusion besides the I'm assuming ethical aspects of the whole situation. So definitely not attractive. Let's see if he mentions the shooting it into the sun though.
Making it even more expensive. A single Saturn V, the rocket used by the Apollo program, which cost around $1.5 billion adjusted for inflation per launch, could get about 43.5 tons from the Earth to the Moon. So we'd need about 260 Saturn V rocket launches every year. And of course, using every the Moon year. As target practice for nuclear waste-tipped rockets kind of makes a huge mess. So maybe don't aim for anything. Space is empty. Do we really need a target? Shooting waste in any random direction is, you guessed it, also a bad idea. Orbits are loops, which means they have a tendency to come back to where they started. Put enough in the sky in random directions, and you'll get one back eventually. So we'd want to launch our nuclear waste deep into space, which means we need even bigger rockets that would be even more expensive. Not that we would be completely safe then. Earth might run into these interplanetary caskets at some time in the far future and experience a pretty...
Imagine if it's hard to convince the people nowadays that depositing nuclear waste underground in permanent repository facilities is good for the next generations. And if we, let's say, give the knowledge to the next generations and inform them about the risks and the location of the waste, then it should work out for hundreds of thousands of years, and people are not convinced, and they're saying that we might introduce danger because people in hundreds of thousands of years might not even know how to handle this situation. Imagine now saying we shoot it into outer space and we hope we will never collide with it again, and we also share the same hope for the future generations to come.
Meteor shower made from radioactive dust. Okay, how about we shoot it into the sun?
Okay, let's see.
Ironically, the sun is pretty hard to hit. While the sun has very strong gravity, everything on Earth is moving with respect to the sun, including the rockets that we launch, meaning a rocket would have to cancel out all the orbital motion it has around the sun so it can stop orbiting and fall in. Because of this, it's actually easier to launch a rocket entirely out of the solar system than it is to launch it into the sun. But to do either of these things, we need even bigger rockets, probably the biggest we've ever built. Nothing works. The thing is, it gets even worse.
Can it?
Problem three, rockets go brrrr.
Yep.
Rocket engineering has taken huge steps since the Apollo era. We've made them relatively safe. We've mostly replaced the toxic explosive cancer fuels of the past decades with much saner mixes of liquid oxygen and hydrogen or kerosene. The newest designs even land themselves so that they can be reused. And yet, out of the 146 launches in 2021, there were 11 failures.
That's like 10% margin to failure. not appealing at all for the nuclear industry.
A sizable number of our rockets carrying high-level radioactive waste would be exploding on the launch pad, or in the worst case, disassembling at high altitude or crashing from hypersonic speeds. Each failure would be at least equivalent to a mini Chernobyl, but instead of being contained under a slab of concrete, spread throughout the atmosphere.
Everywhere.
Radioactive particles could make their way to faraway places by riding on the winds. Most would fall into the ocean, but some would land on the inhabited parts of the world. They could cover farmlands and get concentrated into our food or enter our water supply. Which is, well, bad. Imagine regular large-scale nuclear disasters happening. People wouldn't be happy. Conclusion and opinion part. Nuclear waste is scary, but the fear of it...
I still feel bad for this duck slash bird slash cute animal for carrying this waste without it being contained in a, either some sort of concrete containment or inside water, because this poor duck is not gonna last for long.
And horrible ideas like shooting it into space reveals how bad we are at...
That carpet is full. They need a bigger carpet.
...understanding risk, because the largest amounts of radioactive elements like uranium and radon are actually released by coal. Burning millions of tons of coal each year leaves ash as a waste product that includes about 36,000 tons of radioactive materials. Less radioactive than high-level nuclear waste, but there's also a lot more of it, and it's handled way less carefully. Some of this ash is caught by filters, but most is simply pushed back into leaky mines, shoved into piles exposed to the wind, or poured into ponds that regularly spill into rivers and lakes.
It's nice to see someone discussing about the waste from industries that produce energy that are not nuclear, and actually discussing how it is handled, or better yet, not handled. And comparing that to the nuclear industry, which, yes, the waste is radioactive and it's dangerous, but the high level of security and care for this waste is unseen in the industry.
Living within 1.6 kilometers of an ash pile increases your cancer risk up to 2,000 times over the acceptable limit. And this is on top of other toxic chemicals like heavy metals and, of course, their massive CO2 emissions. And yet, while nuclear energy is flawed and its current form may only be a transitory technology, nuclear power plants are a harder sell than coal. Nuclear waste and the lack of willingness to deal with it are a real issue. It's not...
I'm not quite sure that I agree with the lack of willingness to deal with the nuclear waste, because there's a lot of willingness to deal with the nuclear waste and people are dealing with it. So maybe in this sense, I would like to send some references to Kurzgesagt so they can check it out.
There are good methods to handle it, like burying it deep underground.
Thank you.
Or reprocessing some of it into new fuel. But however we ultimately deal with this issue, we hope one thing is clear. Shooting nuclear waste into space is one of the worst ideas ever.
So that was it. Overall, I absolutely agree with Kurzgesagt and their approach and their conclusion. It is not a good idea to shoot nuclear waste into space. It was never a good idea. That's why it was never implemented or never even really discussed in depth, instead in just only some preliminary research and some, let's say, small work was done on it. And of course, the drawbacks outweigh highly the advantages of it. And we have a much better and a much cheaper solution to store nuclear waste. And this is a solution that the countries are and will be employing in the future, except for the countries that are planning to reprocess. And even in that case, it will still be better to have it stored underground on Earth and then dig it out and reprocess the fuel that you have there, instead of trying to go into outer space and reclaim the fuel that you shot there a couple of decades ago, and trying to reprocess that and bring it down to Earth. It even complicates more the situation for future reprocessing. Overall, as always, very good infographics, very nice video, very well researched, and a lot of references and resources for you guys to check out as well. As I said, I'm going to leave the link to this original video down in the description so you can check it out as well. Thanks so much for watching. Don't forget to like, subscribe, leave a comment down below. Let me know what you thought about this video, and also what kind of videos would you like me to react next. It's been Alina, your friendly nuclear physicist, and until next time, see you soon.